IVM.
Helping us pay our bills this week is PayTM Money.
On this episode of Paisa Paisa, I'm in Bangalore. Yes, I'm meeting all kinds of cool people and cool companies, and I'm doing an entire series of episodes from Bangalore. Hashtag Bangalore Recordings. So on this episode of Paisa Paisa, I speak to Kunal Shah of CRED. Kunal Shah is a really cool founder and investor in many, many startups. And in this first part of our two-part series, I'm going to be talking to him about the founder's manual. There are three things that founders struggle with: strategy, funding, and people. We're going to talk about all three with Kunal Shah of CRED in this first episode of the Bangalore Recordings. Stay tuned for that. I get that, you know, because these numbers, so many numbers and these tables and these columns and all that, it gets a little bit difficult to understand these representations. But guess what? The PayTM Money app has just simplified all of this and made it into cooler bars and graphs. And, you know, it's like the graphical representations of your funds will actually help you monitor your funds better. They've got some nice funky stuff out there. So download the app. You know, you can get the PayTM Money app from the Android Play Store or the Apple App Store. And mutual funds ke liye bhi PayTM karo. Folks, welcome to Paisa Paisa. I'm your host Anupam Gupta, B50 on Twitter. And this is the Bangalore special. Starting off with this nice blockbuster episode, because my guest today is Kunal Shah, founder and CEO of CRED. Kunal is a founder and investor in God alone knows how many startups. You're going to talk to him about that. Most notably, FreeCharge, which was sold to Snapdeal in 2015. Since last year, Kunal's new company is CRED, that's C-R-E-D, which, to use his own words, is the most rewarding credit card payment app ever. And I think I can testify that I'm a user. It's seriously good. Okay, we'll get to CRED in a bit. We'll start something else that I know is close to Kunal's heart. Okay, so Kunal, welcome to the show. Thank you so much for doing this for us. Let's start with entrepreneurship, the kind of people that you've met, from founders to investors. The sheer range of experience that you have when you talk to people is something that I'm sure that our listeners would be very interested in, because I know that I have a lot of listeners who are founders, who are entrepreneurs, who are struggling with what I see as three key issues. Just tell me if I'm off track. But I want to start from there. Okay. First is strategy. Second is funding. And third is people. So let's go with that.
Sure. I think, first of all, thank you for having me.
My pleasure.
And I'm glad you're a happy customer. That's good to know. I think concept of entrepreneurship has been fairly confused in at least the startup entrepreneurs that I have seen. We forget that business has only one objective: provide something that what consumers need, and if it's valuable, you will probably get some money for that. And if you forget that principle, you're more likely to kind of always make mistakes. A lot of times I have seen entrepreneurs take business models from different parts of the world and try to apply over here. I'll give you the simplest example is that there was a time where 8 companies that were funded were doing laundry startup.
Wow.
And this may make sense in New York. It does not make sense over here, because we have currently still a solution that we have a domestic help coming at home. And therefore, creating value through a laundry startup is almost irrelevant. But a lot of times when people have not understood how to create value, and I think it boils down to the fact that none of the guys have earned a single rupee when they were in school, college, maybe after that. And if you just jump into becoming a founder, I don't think you can just become good at it, right? And if you've...
That's provocative.
Well, I don't see it happening. I've probably met 1,000 founders, and sure, I've seen a pattern from that, and this is my observation.
Of course.
I think the second thing is about strategy. I think a lot of people have this thing that, oh, let's start and let's pivot and let's pivot and let's pivot. The point is, why can't you plan better, right? Why can't there be enough amount of research that you do before you build a product? Because once you start building something, you are invested in it. And it's very hard for you to kind of backtrack once you've committed to that. And then confirmation bias kicks in. The sunk cost fallacy, as we know in the investment world. Yeah. Same thing for building a product. And once you start making a company, it feels like your child and you cannot see it's ugly, right? And then therefore you keep fighting with it, and there is an eventual death that happens in 2 or 3 years. Sometimes you can extend that, but that's very painful. I have never seen founders come back from bad failures. Why go into that direction? There are enough ways to test. So I don't see, like, I deal with technology founders a lot, and I have seen that they like how to code. So the first thing they do is code something instead of talking to 5 customers, 20 customers. So I think that is a big problem on strategy, that we take Western models, A. B, we tend to build before talking to the customers and really knowing if there is a gap that can be solved by your solution. And third is that really, like, planning better instead of just kind of jumping into this. A lot of people say, oh, I have to leave a job to start up. No, I mean, the smartest founders continue to be in a job when they start building a company on the side. So,
and you're not one that believes in, I believe in my passion, I'll quit my job and tomorrow I'll make a startup.
Yeah, I mean, I have seen those to be more roadkills than anything else. I think, okay. I think that entrepreneurship is not a college festival that you're going to have fun in. It's a fairly dark journey, and when you're committing to it, you better be sure what you're getting into. It'll take probably years, decade to kind of get to believing that something really worked, right? So something meaningful happening will take that much time. There is no shortcuts to that. So I think this coolness around startups, I actually get worried about this, because I don't think people are learning from their mistakes also. So that's the first thing on strategy. Now, coming to funding, it's a big problem. I think we are... we are believing that funding is a necessary step to do a startup. It's like equivalent to saying that unless I have Nike shoes, I cannot run. It doesn't work that way.
And this is, people are not going to like this, right? Because the assumption is, I have an idea, give me $100 million.
Yeah, because that's the narrative. Because what happens is, in media, the only news that gets covered is our funding. Nothing about, nobody is interested in knowing how did I research about CRED. Nobody's ever asked me how many months of research was done into that, prototyping, surveys. Nobody's interested in that story. You know,
I hope we're going to go into that later.
But I think that general narrative has been about, and one more thing that is wrong in India is that whenever, if you see an Uber IPO happening, you will see the US newspapers never show the CEO's picture or the founder's picture on the news. They show the Uber logo, right? In India, you will see any news appearing for any founder or any startup, they put the founder's full-size picture. That now that creates this massive envy cycle, and instead of news, they are stories. And that's a fundamental problem in this, because what happens is that we believe that is what is required, right? And unfortunately, if you think about the situation where we've got people who are now saying, hey, I need funding, only then I can start up, then they are fundamentally wrong, right? Most of the entrepreneurs in this country before this generation started up without any capital. They took loans, they borrowed money, they mortgaged their own houses to get to do something, right?
Family jewelry.
Yeah, of course. Like, why are you thinking that is a thing? And I think It's a big problem that we're dealing with right now, because I don't think we can create a startup culture without that. Coming to people, I think...
I want to just stop you right there on the funding part. Okay, that's from the entrepreneur's angle. Is there anything you want to put in from the investor's angle out here? When they, you know, let's say that I'm an angel and I've invested in a startup and, you know, and suddenly there's a mismatch between... I signed up, let's say, for 3 tranches, and after first, second, I'm just lost out there. So there's this very gentle equation between investors and entrepreneurs. Okay, let's assume that the entrepreneur's gone actually a few steps further and gotten funding. How do we solve this entire thing? I was talking even to Amit Somani about this thing. I had an entire episode with him. It seems to be, and I'm talking pre-Series A, because I'm assuming that by Series A, things are kind of sorted and, you know, the equation between entrepreneur and investor is more or less okay. How do we crack this at the starting level?
I think, first of all, we forget that investors are not your relatives, right? They will support you if you have the substance. Either you have the ability to demonstrate a future picture, or you have real traction that you can demonstrate. Without that, you cannot really expect them to be friendly to you. I would like to give an analogy of, let's say an attractive person in school or college, right? Like a male, female. Now, they have inbound interest. But usually a person who's constantly going and proposing to 25 people is less likely to be considered to be attractive, right? Investor sentiment is very human in similar ways.
Sure.
Right? If you have traction, if a lot of people are wanting to invest in your company, automatically you'll have all the investors you want. But going to 25 investors and pitching to them and saying that, hey, I've been pitching for the last 6 months, you're not going to get there.
Understood.
So my view is that a lot of times, and there are a lot of these interesting, I would say, middlemen brokers have come in to say, oh, we'll help you get funding. It's no different than, like, I don't know, matchmaking clients who are just giving you all the hope. So I think we are in a serious situation where we are not understanding that when you make a company, you have to empathize with everybody, including your team, your customers, your investors, to your co-founders, right? That means you have to understand what do they want and how do you kind of offer that to them so they work with you. Most people don't empathize with investors. They're like, my idea was perfect. And they will read this one story of, let's say, Airbnb, and they said, oh, nobody understood that company, right? But that's completely wrong, right? Maybe your idea is completely nonsense. And I think and in India, we have a massive problem of sugarcoating feedback.
I was going to come to that. How do you be brutal to yourself?
We are not brutal. In fact, you made a comment that you're going to have trouble in this podcast by saying certain things. I think we are just designed to sugarcoat everything, and therefore we mislead people into doing wrong things. Instead of giving frank feedback, now people don't have to take frank feedback and like disintegrate because of your feedback. I mean, in fact, they should take that and say, valid point, I'm going to fix that in my offering. But what we do is we like, oh, bahut sahi hai, this is great, why don't you continue? And right after that meeting, we'll like, oh, what an idiot. Like that kind of discussion. I think that does not help the entrepreneurs.
Sure.
I think our response, and by the way, family is never going to give you good feedback. Friends are not going to give you feedback because they have
invested
all designed.
Interest, yeah.
Because we are all sugarcoating society, right? We are fairly hypocritical when it comes to certain things. And I think, therefore, looking for harsh feedback. So when I meet people and I say, oh, don't tell me all the things that you love about CRED. Tell me all the stuff that you don't like. And I need to be fixing that because all the things you love will continue to be there. And I just need to understand what's wrong. And I think that is not the culture.
Okay.
And that is a big problem. And I think investor is the same thing, right? If you get a no, right, how many have a mature discussion saying that what are the three things that I would do today would make you want to invest in this company? If you ask this mature question, every investor will answer this question for you. But because investors are used to like dramatic reactions of getting a no, they're like, oh, we'll come back to you and never give you frank feedback. So we are just creating a perpetuating cycle of just being not being honest.
Fantastic. And on that note, we take a break on this Founders Manual episode with Kunal Shah of CRED. Don't go anywhere. We're going to be right back.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to another awesome week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you are not following us on social media, please make sure you do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We'd like to thank our sponsors this month, Savari Storytel and PayTM Money. Also, guys, I just want to remind you that we do these audiograms on our social media. Audiograms are short snippets from episodes which are interesting to listen to. Check them out. I think you'll enjoy them. Also, guys, we are doing a podcast with Ronnie Screwala called The Ronnie Screwala Podcast. And on that podcast, on the last episode, we're going to have Ronnie answer a bunch of listener questions. If you'd like to send us a question, please send it to us at dreaming@ivmpodcast.com. Also, do check out our YouTube page where we have Ronnie talking to Cyrus on Cyrus Says. We have a bunch of short clips there which I think you'll enjoy. This week on Shunya One, Shiladitya and I are joined by Hitesh Malhotra, the Chief Marketing Officer of Nykaa, to talk about various aspects of marketing. On Equity Sahi Hai, brought to you by Motilal Oswal Asset Management, Shrey Lunkar talks to Anupam about life insurance and what the product is all about. On the Habit Coach podcast, Ashton tells you different ways to manage and control stress and how it will impact your life in a positive way. On Know Your Kanun, Amber talks about the structure, power and characteristics of the recently passed Lokpal Bill. On the Pragati podcast, Anand Arni, ex-member of RAW and Pranay Kothastane, head of the Geostrategy program at Takshashila, discussed the upcoming election in Afghanistan. On Advertising is Dead, Varun is joined by Harshit Chavan, managing director of Toast Events, to talk about the growth of digital media, influencer marketing, and the famous Gap Dabbawala campaign. On the ATKT Talent Tent, hosts P-Man and Krupa are joined by singer-songwriter Naila Saldana. They discuss the strict dress codes followed by colleges in India. On Positively Unlimited, Chetna talks about different aspects of relationship, unrequited love, heartbreaks, closures, and how to find your soulmates. And with that, let's get you on with your show.
And welcome back to the Founders Manual with Kunal Shah of CRED. How important is it 2, how do you get the right co-founders? And 3, how do you get the right people? Because I firmly believe that people is really what will take your product to scale and to market or whatever the terms are. What are your thoughts on that?
I think first of all, co-founders. I have never seen any co-founder relationship that is recently made to ever work. Unless you know the person for 7, 8, 10 years and have known them intimately, I don't think that relationship works.
So you can't hold interviews for co-founders?
Absolutely not. No, or you can go to conference and say, I'm looking for a tech co-founder. It doesn't, never works.
Wow, okay.
Because a co-founder relationship is something that we need to intimately know somebody and suffer with them. And you need to prepare for how will you deal with each other when things are not going right or when things are going very well. So unless you have battle-tested that person in extreme circumstances of good and bad times, I don't think co-founder relationships work. And therefore, finding co-founder is usually a very terrible idea, according to me. In terms of other people, I think it's never easy, right? A lot of people make mistakes of, like, let's define the stage of a startup. A 0-to-1 startup is that it's a seed idea and you want to just build some traction. A lot of people who will join that time are mostly irrational, right? They're probably leaving a stable job, a stable income.
Full-on passion overload types.
Right? And they're like, they're not making sense. They're just jumping onto a ship saying that, oh, let's go attack this island and we have no idea even if the island exists, right? And it's okay if we don't find it, right? So you need a bunch of irrational people. If you get a lot of rational people who are going to get shaken by every turn of the ship hitting a turbulent water, they're going to drain energy out of you.
Wow.
So you need people who are going to be, oh, let's go. Like, oh, choppy waters, let's go more further. and you want to make sure that they are constantly the one who are giving you energy versus taking energy out of you.
Interesting.
So I think I would test that. I think in terms of competence and skills, you need somebody who can do many things together.
Wow,
if they say, I can do only one thing properly, it never works for an early stage startup. You want the guy to be able to do at least 3 different things for the company. Mm. Otherwise, you end up swelling the company and again losing money all that you have collected to kind of do that. So I think generalist, mercenaries, irrational to the point of getting excited about ambiguity.
Mm.
I think those are the factors I would think about for getting people in early stage startup.
So I'll give you 2 models out there. One is a sniper, okay, who's got crazy execution, list of kills, okay. And he's really good at what he does, but that's all he does. Versus a very stylized assassin who just walks into a bar and kills a lot of people, but he takes a lot of risk on himself. I don't know whether this is similar to what you're saying. I'm trying to look at the difference between passion, pure passion, okay, and execution. I think both are important. What's your view on where this line lies between the sniper and the assassin? Who do you think is...
I would not classify them in this way. I would say that can they kill?
Can that's a basic requirement.
Yeah. I think elegance in killing is good because you burn less resources, right? The best definition of a predator is somebody who burns the least amount of calories to earn the most amount of calories, right? So you'll never see a predator going crazy running to acquire a target. They usually hunt at watering holes and burn the least amount of energy, but their bite is the deadliest bite. So the question is that do you want to just have people... you don't want to judge their killing style, but more about... are they likely to kill when they were assigned to kill?
Okay, understood. I want to end this part on 2 things, okay? Some truly bizarre stuff that you've seen. Okay, could be anecdotes, could be anything that kind of bring out these points on strategy, people, funding, whatever it is. And the third is some shocking data, right? Because I know that you've got tons of this. Maybe stuff like percentage of failures or whatever it is.
Sure.
Let's start with the bizarre, the truly bizarre. You travel like mad, I know that. You know how many languages? I was told, I think, by someone that you know some crazy amount of languages. You met a lot of people. So I want to get some real juicy anecdotes that kind of, you know, that our listeners, when they listen to it, they get an idea that entrepreneurship, startups, the romance is all fine. There's a whole big world outside of that, beyond that. Because I think a lot of us are probably born and brought up on Steve Jobs.
Yeah.
And think that, dude, mere ko to Steve Jobs banne ka hai. What's the ugly shit out there?
I think... I mean, the bizarre stuff that I always think about is that they look at only the positive stories and all these enthusiastic stuff, right? Oh, like, let's take an example of Vijay at PayTM, right? Like, how many people know about his struggle and his challenges to get what he's got right now, right? And what has made Vijay what Vijay is, right? But that stuff is not interesting, right? You want to know about his new funding. You want to know about his new conference speech where he's giving a positive approach. And I think that is not really helping. So the bizarre stuff that I've seen is that I look like I'm the only founder which talks about the dark side and does not make me popular in a lot of conferences. But I think it is important.
People just want to be a Luke Skywalker.
Yeah, they just want to listen to positive stuff. And according to me, people who are addicted to motivational stuff stay addicted to motivational stuff. They never get anything done. Right? So I think you have to always check, are you a motivational speech addict or are you a realist? I think you will always see that one type of person is more successful than the other.
Understood.
I mean, that's bizarre for me that people are just so addicted to motivational stuff. The second thing that I think is quite bizarre is the whole idea of copying Western ideas over here. And I've touched upon it earlier, but I'll give a few examples, right? Like, you're building something, right? For example, one person was coming and saying that I've built this thing where people can find a partner to do play tennis in a city, and this is some startup in the US that they had copied.
Okay.
I said, do you understand that every community in the US has free tennis courts and therefore the market size is significantly better by the virtue of doing that? In India, how many tennis courts exist in the city are you existing?
Hardly, man.
But they did not know. So that's the thing.
Oh.
Zero market understanding. I asked them three questions. How many tennis courts exist in the city? No idea. How many tennis rackets have been bought in the city in the history of like last 5-10 years? No idea. I said, how many people are playing tennis today, right now, or are interested? No idea. But they've already built an app to find a tennis partner to go play tennis and all of that stuff. So the question is that the most bizarre thing I find out that people get into this super niche sectors without understanding the market size. You cannot take a fancy idea of the West and just start applying over here just because it sounds cool.
Mm.
Nobody is interested in that. Right. For example, like talking about investment products, like I see everybody building this cool investment products, but the whole country has got money in CASA and fixed deposits and nobody has built product for that. And I'm like, if people love A, why are you constantly building B, C, D? Because it gives you higher return, because most people don't understand higher returns.
So help me find the best bank account instead of help me find the best mutual fund.
Or find give me a platform to do investment fixed deposits in a seamless way.
Oh, fixed deposit. People don't somehow like that. And I'm actually a believer in fixed deposits. Anyway, go on, please.
Well, but the thing is, if you look at data, I think that's the whole thing, right? If we take decisions based on emotions and what we like and what we not like, I think we're going to be terrible at making products. For example, if most of the country is keeping money in CASA and most of the country is investing in fixed deposits, then why do you want to build these fancy platforms of investment where people don't even understand the concept of compound interest, right? Recently on Twitter, I asked somebody that would you take 2 crores upfront and this and...
2 lakhs per month for... If I got the... Folks, here's a question, okay? Choice A, would you take 20 crores right now? Like, in this moment, right now, if we give a check to you, sign it to you and give you, I don't know the number, it's either 2 crores or 20 crores, but essentially a large piece of sum right now to you, okay? And option B, I'll give you 2 lakhs a month for the...
Or 10 lakhs a month.
Or 10 lakhs a month, okay? For the rest of your life. Which option will you choose? Kunal, go. Yeah, Kunal, so option one, like I said, was take a very large amount of sum right now. And option B was take a small amount of money every month for the rest of your life. And people chose option B.
Yeah. So I think what I've noticed is that people don't understand the concept of compound interest, and therefore they think of everything in from a lens of salary, right? If you tell somebody that they earn 20 crores upfront and 10 lakh rupees every month for your entire life, they don't understand inflation, they don't understand compound interest, they don't understand any of those things. And I think that's a very concerning thing. Like, financial education has been completely missing for the country. And by the way, this is the educated sector. People who follow me are not educated, right? And I think, I mean, I got a stand-up comedian to do the same survey. They got 82% to select option B. So that's mean, and this is somebody who does stand-up comedy, which is still high IQ, right? So my point is that if we are creating investment platforms for people that fundamentally does not understand investments, we are just making a mistake, right? This country is used to saying, oh, maine apartment liya tha 10 lakh rupees mein 10 saal pehle, abhi 20 lakhs ho gaya. Like, they don't understand that what was the IRR, what kind of compound interest that you should be kind of looking at, and so on and so forth.
Leave alone opportunity cost. So, toh dur ki baat hai.
Yeah. So I think that is a big problem. I think we need to solve for that. And it's going to be a key factor on this country's per capita income growing.
Sure.
Unless we fix that. Coming to the second part where you asked me some bizarre stats and data.
Yes.
94% of credit cards are owned by men.
No.
92% of home loans, 92% of personal loans are taken by men.
Hold that thought. 94% of all credit cards are owned by men.
Yeah.
I thought you'll go with 80% or even 75%.
No. 92% of all personal loans are owned by men. 95% of almost car loans and home loans are by men.
Okay.
India has the lowest women participation of labor in urban India.
Yeah,
just to give you a sense, Bangladesh has 6x more, 6 times more women working in Bangladesh, and their per capita income is going to cross us very fast because of that. In fact, my data is suggesting that Pakistan is going to cross us on women participation of labor.
Wow. Our neighbors are doing better than us on something as basic, as critical, as important.
When I ask this question to most people, that how many women do you think work in urban India? They say 50%.
Yeah.
But have you seen an airport? How many queues are for women? How many compartments in a metro are for women? And that's right. The whole point. You will never really understand data if you don't pay attention to that.
Mm.
And I think no country has crossed $3,000 per capita without women participation of labor.
Wow.
Only Saudi Arabia managed to cross $3,000.
These are not countries that we want to compare ourselves with.
But the point is that we are actually behind Bangladesh and Pakistan.
Man, that's bizarre. That's totally bizarre. And that's a wrap on this Founders Manual episode of Paisa Vaisa. My guest is Kunal Shah, founder of CRED, founder and investor in many, many startups, and an all-round cool guy. I hope you enjoyed this episode with Kunal. I'm your host, Anupam Gupta, B50 on Twitter. And that's a wrap on this episode of Paisa Vaisa.
No material on the show should be considered as financial advice. The material on the show is for informational purposes only. Please consult a financial advisor before taking any investment decision.
Do you wish you were smarter? Well, so do we. But the next best thing?
We could make you sound smarter.
And to help you with this endeavor, we are Simplified, a podcast that attempts to break down the complex world around you with a little knowledge, a lot of poor jokes, and a ton of random trivia.
Episodes out every Monday
on the IVM Podcast app or wherever you get your podcasts.
See ya!
The most engaging and the most useful conversations you may have in your life are likely to be with your most challenging customers. Hi, I'm Ambi Parmeshwaran, and on this podcast, I will take you through my book, Sponge: Leadership Lessons I Learned from My Clients. Packed with real stories about real people, but most of all, packed with the innumerable lessons I soaked up from some of the most iconic business leaders like Ratan Tata, Azim Premji, S. Ramadurai, Karsanbhai Patel, M. Damodaran, Dr. Kurian, and many more. Don't forget to tune in to the Sponge Podcast. Keep sponging to keep learning.